It's working? Yes. So good evening, everyone. My name is Karan Singh, and I'm working as a systems specialist in CSC ID Center for Science in Finland. My roles of duty in CSC currently is to build up software-defined storage, which is Ceph, for all our OpenStack-based cloud computing needs. So in day-to-day, I'm working on Ceph and a part of one OpenStack. In my free time, I'm writing some books on Ceph as well as some blogs that I do in my free time. A very quick intro about PSC. So it's funded in 1971. It's a non-profit company funded by Minister of Education, and in past, CSC has done a couple of great things like connecting Finland to internet in 1988, and we are running one of the most powerful academic computing facility in the Nordics, ISO certified, and we also have our own public cloud offerings with the name of Pota Cloud Services that we are running. You could follow these links to get more information on CSC's cloud offerings. So the Pota Cloud Service is an infrastructure as service, and here we have two different flavors of cloud, I would say, which is CPOTA and ePOTA. I'm using these terms here because in the coming slides I'm using the same term, so it would be a bit easier for you guys to understand what I'm referring to. So these are CSC specific brand names, I would say. So CPOTA and ePOTA, which are public and private clouds built for general purpose as well as for other use cases like sensitive data. All these clouds are built on top of OpenStack, and we are not using any kind of distribution for OpenStack. We are using upstream releases from community, and for storage we currently do Ceph and unfortunately non-Ceph storage backends. But in coming years or in coming months, I would say we are planning to move completely to Ceph. So there are some reasons why we choose Ceph is build our own storage, so not to buy black boxes or very nice enterprise solution from companies. We are looking forward for a solution which should be software defined, so, and that should integrates quite nicely with our OpenStack needs. So that's why we chose Ceph, and we are also having use cases for object storage. So a solution which is giving us block and object as well as file in future, it would be really nice to do that. And some more things why we choose Ceph is to remove single point of failure from our existing OpenStack based clouds from storage point of view. So in the next slide we'll talk more about that, how we are trying to remove the single point of failure from our storage architectures. And even OpenStack alone is too complex, so we are planning to make it a bit less complex by introducing Ceph, so that we should be rest assured from the storage point of view. So this is something that we have currently, and so currently we are doing different kinds of storage chunks for Cinder, Nova instances, and Glance, as you can see in the picture. So we are doing a set of own. So we have enterprise array. We are giving LUNs to mapping those LUNs to gateway and using those gateways with Cinder for block storage. And on the other side, we are using local storage for Nova for instances, and we are also using NFS for Glance. So you can see we have quite varied amount of storage with OpenStack, which is quite a bit complex for us to manage. So this is something we want to do, and we are doing on ePOTA currently. So we want to use Ceph for all the needs, like for Cinder, Swift, Glance, Keystone. So this is something that we are doing in one of the cloud. And for another cloud solution. We are going to dump up this model and bring in Ceph there. So we should enjoy all the features that Ceph is giving with OpenStack. And yes, to mention, probably in coming years, OpenStack Manila, which is the shared file system service. So we definitely look forward to use that service as well with our OpenStack. Okay, I will tell you a bit about our hardware that we are using. So currently we are using five different Ceph storage clusters inside CSC, which are of course including testing and development boxes. So this is the configuration of our ePOTA cloud service that I have mentioned before. And in the next slide, we have another service, which is a CPOTA cloud service and a POC for Fujitsu. So let's take this one first. So here we have three different clusters, production, test, and development. So we are following the DevOps way of doing things. So we try to do all the testing on the development and test clusters and move them to production once we are quite confident enough. So in development and test, we are running Hammer and CentOS 6 with HP's FET node, including 60 drive, 4 terabyte. And the production and test clusters are a little bit same. So it's just the difference between the number of nodes. So we are using 10, it's a pretty small cluster. So 10 machines, HP DL380 with 12 into 3 terabyte of SATA. So this is how the production looks like. And in the test, we have exactly the same hardware with 5 nodes. So the thing is that we were looking to make test and production look bit similar with respect to hardware, but in the development side, we are playing with quite fat boxes. So this is the ePOTA cloud storage that we have. And this one is for CPOTA cloud storage. So it's again, HPSL 4550 fat nodes with 64 terabyte disks. We are using this storage for object solution. We are currently not using it for block, but yes, I'm pretty sure very soon we are going to use this for Ceph block storage for OpenStack. So this is something we are going to do quite soon. And we have a Fujitsu Eternus CD10000 storage appliance, which we are testing, or we are doing the proof of concept with Fujitsu. So we have not purchased this box. We are just playing around the system and just checking out how does it works with OpenStack. So it's not a big solution. So for primary machines that Fujitsu solution comes with, it do have one Fusion IO card for journals. And the machine also, the solution also comes with a management node. So it's a 5-node cluster that we have currently with single switches. So there is no HA with this configuration. So because this is just for POC, so we are just playing with these machines. So these are the 5 clusters that we currently have. Okay, and in the next slide, I will talk a little bit about how or what kind of tools we are using with our current Ceph environments. So for deployment purpose and package management, we are using Spacewalk. All of these tools are open source. So we mostly prefer open source solutions. So we are using all these tools. Ansible, we are using heavily with end-to-end system configuration. As soon as the system builds using Spacewalk, we are using Ansible to do other configuration like kernel tuning packages and setting up monitor configurations. I mean the monitoring configuration, which is Grafana and CollectD, so not the Ceph monitors. And then configuring those nodes with the central logging thing. So all of these things or the system admin work, we are automating it using Ansible. Once the system is ready, we do we use Ansible again to deploy the Ceph cluster for us. So we have built up the Ansible playbooks by ourselves, so based on our own environment. So we are not using the Ansible scripts which are available on the community. So we have built up these something for within CSC. And then some normal system administration work we are also doing with Ansible. From metrics and performance data collection, we are using CollectD, Grafana, and Graphite. So CollectD is agents which are collecting information about the system metrics and pushing these informations to Graphite, which is storing all these changes, all these data. And we are publishing nice dashboards that we will look in the next slide using Grafana. So this gives us a very nice picture of what our cluster is doing in a time-lapse manner. For monitoring and logs management, we are using OpsView and Elasticsearch, Logstash, and Kibana stack. Though this part is not in production, currently I'm working on it, and hopefully soon I will do all my Ceph logs with Elk stack quite soon. And we are using then Git for all our configuration management. Okay, so now I will try to connect to VPN. I'm already connected to VPN. So I'll show you about the dashboards that we have built up and how does it look like. It should come here. Yes, you can see it. Just a minute. Coming full. Yes, it's almost coming full. So let's have a look on one of the Ceph cluster that we have. So this is the live view of our cluster. So this data is coming from CollectD is collecting all the metrics from the systems and pushing it to Graphite, and Grafana is the web interface which is showing us all the data in a nice dashboard form. So this is our cluster, which is this is the capacity of our cluster currently, and this is the current throughput which is coming out. So just to show you here, I have put some scripts which is writing to the Ceph pool. So this is the information which is coming from. Okay, something is broken. No data points. So these are Ceph OSDs. So it says that total we have 240 OSDs and all of them are up and nothing is down. So cluster is quite happy right now, and the data is coming quite in real time. So it's latest from 20 minutes before. And about Ceph monitors, and then there is a section for placement groups. It is telling about what all placement groups are here, and then number of pools, how many pools we have. So we are having 32 pools right now, and then pool utilization and objects per pool. So this is all information. So if we can change this using the timeline here. So if I go for 24 hours, so I can easily see the data or state of my cluster, what was going in by going back to this or adjusting the time here. So CollectD gives us the flexibility to see what our cluster was doing previously. So this was the state of my cluster. It looks quite nice. So now I will show you the cluster which is currently not good, just to show you how does it look like. So this is one cluster which has been crying or recovering. It's currently recovering. So you can see here, so the nodes are coming up and going down. So you can see the cluster total capacity is going away with it. The throughput is also because cluster is recovering, and you can see the IOPS they are quite peak. You can see the latency, and then you can see this one, a Ceph OSD. So it was running quite nice. All the OSDs were up. Then suddenly OSDs got break, and they are coming up, going down, coming up, going down. So this is generating the logs here. Ceph monitors. So we have three monitors, and out of which one is currently down. So we have in quorum two monitors. So this is the state of our placement groups. So you can see here, you can sort this with the placement group or type of or the state of placement group that is currently doing. So this is quite bad, which is because the cluster is recovering. That's why I showed to you, because it's in real time. So this is how it is for the Ceph clusters. Now, if we have also configured the same thing for all of our Ceph nodes. So while troubleshooting, it would be quite nice, quite easy for us to get down to that node which is giving problem to us. So I have all my dashboards already saved here. So if I go to this, so if I go to this node, so this matrix is specific to my node 0202. Similarly, I have configured for all the other nodes. So all the metrics is coming in this form. So you can see the system load, CPU utilization of this machine, network utilization, memory utilization. So that's right. How? It really depends, because you will see this cluster currently is recovering since this morning. I just came here and switched to connect to my VPN, and I saw that cluster is recovering. So it's still recovering. So I have to log in and check and what it's doing. So I have no current clue of what was the reason for it's broken, because I'm here. This is the question. I have not checked it right now. There, there has been some mount point which is full. The VAR mount point is full. That's why monitor is down currently.
What is full?
The mount point.
Oh, the mount.
The
point.
VAR. Yeah. So I have not got time to troubleshoot deeply and just see how it looked like. So, but I'll do it later.
Yeah, that actually leads me to another question. You monitor the number of monitors in the quorum. You don't monitor them the size of each monitor, right?
No, not currently.
Okay.
But there's something. It's a good thought to.
Yeah, because.
So yeah, that's important. Yeah, but we currently do not monitor the size of monitors, level DB or something.
Yeah, are the monitors sitting on dedicated disks? Or are they sharing the?
They are not on dedicated disk. They are sharing the disk.
Yeah. So one thing that usually happens is that when the cluster is under heavy load, you will generate a bunch of logs for Ceph, and that can deplete the available space in the host.
That's true. Yeah.
And the monitors go down.
That's why we are configuring the central logging, so we should not write on the local system. The logs would be immediately sent to the syslog server. So
okay.
We are in the process of setting this up. So you can deep down to the disk level also, which disk is doing a lot of writes or reads, or the IOPS part of it. So we have configured this in this way. So so this was the demo that I was intending to show you guys. How are we doing here? And now let's back to the presentation. So our it's coming good. Our near future things that we are planning to do is currently we are having we are not having a very big Ceph cluster set up, but we have needs that allow us to build up multi-scale, multi-petabyte solutions. So we are looking forward to the storage pod layout, which is which was inspired by the Flickr way of doing. So as he mentioned before, Flickr is doing a lot of small clusters. I'm not sure about the size of the cluster, but they are collecting all the small clusters and doing a pod layout thing. So this is our future that we are looking towards. So it's currently on papers. So we about the storage layout is currently on paper. So we have not done the real work which is required to achieve this. And then we are also looking forward for dedicated monitor nodes, SSD journals for because we don't have SSD journals currently. The SSD the journals are on the same disk as the data disk. So we are looking forward to get dedicated SSD disks. Then definitely for erasure coding we want to check out. And for another storage cluster, we probably by this year end we would be adding around 850 terabyte of capacity because we have hardware to it. So we will just simply add the hardware to our existing cluster. And for the same cluster, we are looking forward for full support to OpenStack so that we should remove the storage complexity that we currently have. So this is our future of Ceph that we are looking inside CSC. And here are some long-term goals that we have. So building up a multi-petabyte, almost 10 petabyte usable capacity cluster. And the storage layout thing that we are still wondering how we should achieve this and what's the best way to do it with a multi-petabyte cluster. And then, yes, one of the key targets that we are looking towards is multi-data center replication between two different location in CSC. So in CSC we have a data center in Espoo and one data center in Kayani, and we are looking forward to have a multi-data center application using RBD mirror or something with Ceph. So this comes in our long-term plans. But yes, in the next slide I will try to concentrate on the storage pod layouts that we are looking forward. And yes, if you guys have a better solution to do that, so please interrupt me and give your feedback. So this is how it looks like. You have a Ceph node is a collection of bunch of disks, and then you will get a lot of these machines, rack them up, you will have multi-rack environment. So, and when you want to scale up, you will simply add a couple of these racks, and Ceph should take care of your data. Data replication as well as data hiveability, so Ceph will do it. But the thing is how to manage it more efficiently. That's why we thought of introducing storage pods. So a storage pod would be a logical group of racks. So that might help us in easy ease of management and hyperscale for hyperscale environment. It would look like as a scalable modular design in which we will tune crush to write the copy of data on the failure zones, which are pods. So, and definitely the secondary and the tertiary copy in different storage pods. So this should look like this. We will have pod 1, pod 2, and pod 3, and each pod minimum should have one rack. And if you want to scale this, you will simply add the rack to the pod, and Ceph will do the rebalancing stuff across racks. And even if you want to scale this to another level, so you will simply add couple of more racks to the same pod. So Ceph should again do the rebalancing thing for you. And for a multi-pod infrastructure, it should look like this. So you will definitely, we don't have this, and I'm not sure when we will have such kind of setup, like hundreds of racks. So we look, but it should look like this in pictures. So you will have multiple racks clubbed together in the form of pods, and Ceph should be tuned in such a way that it should write the data in a failure domain to the pods. So if you can follow the colored, it's showing colors, yes. So if you can follow the colors, it should tell you it's writing the data on one pod. Parallelly, it's replicating the same data on the another pod. So you would achieve a pod level of failure domain. But again, this picture, this is just in figures, this is just in presentation that we have. We will looking forward to implement this. All right, so here are some recommendations that we have collected or we have learned so far with Ceph. Using dedicated monitors and avoid sharing OSD nodes with it. And the second one is using SSDs for monitors. These are two things that we currently don't have in our infrastructure, but yes, we are looking forward to implement those two things with our top priority. With respect to OSDs, it's good to use SSD journals, but it's pretty bad to overload the journal. So at the end, you will not get what you are expected. So if you are building your cluster, so please do not overload your SSDs.
But what do you mean by overloading? Is there any, let's say, gold number of OSDs per SSD you could have?
Various sources says different number of OSDs, but as per Red Hat and Intent, they typically recommend 4 to 5 OSDs per SSD. So this is something. I have seen a presentation from, I think that was Deutsche Telekom. They were using 4 OSDs per journal, but they ran into problem. Then they moved to 3. So it really depends. But the ideal number would be between 3 to 5. It depends on the performance of your discussion. So that should be an ideal number. We currently don't have this, but this SSD I'm talking about from the monitor point of view. Oh, sorry. From monitor, you should keep your level DB or the monitor DB on the SSD. That will give you better performance and scalability as well, as he mentioned before in his presentation.
But Karan, I understand that this is good for performance, but is there an idea to use this Ceph installation you're speaking about for virtual machines mainly, or also for some kind of large scale long-term storage? Because in the second case, I would not see that many SSDs. Of course, this is nice to have, but cost-wise, it would perhaps not be the cheapest possible solution.
What do you mean about the long-term?
I think about using Ceph-based storage as an alternative to tape stuff, to tape-based archives. Because I know that this large number of SSDs per OSD is kind of good practice for high performance systems. Yeah, but for
for a system that you are not looking forward for a big performance or a capacity oriented nodes, so definitely you can drop SSDs and you can use like a thick node without SSD. So that should work. Yeah, in practice, yeah. And then it's a big question still, like what kind of node should be used with Ceph. So I tried to divide it in 3 different ways and making a preference out of it. So my first preference would be to use thin nodes with less number of disks. And second preference would be to use thick nodes. And definitely if you're using fat nodes, so I would recommend, or even Red Hat and Inktank recommends to use several of them, because if you have a fat node and you have, let's suppose, 4 nodes that we have in our development cluster, so if you're losing a big fat node, you are losing more than 20 or 25 or 30% of your cluster, which is quite dangerous. So it's nice to have multiple such fat nodes, so even if you lose 1 or 2 nodes, your cluster degradation should not affect too much. So you can use fat nodes, but try to use them in more quantity. Yeah. So this is about OSDs. Now some operational experiences that we had with Ceph is, you should use dedicated OS disks, or I would say try avoiding using same disk for SSD, same disk for OSD and same disk for OS. So keep operating system disk away from the OSD, because in our setup right now we are doing this. We are using OS disk as a partition and giving the rest of the remaining partition to the OSD, but this is something you should not do, and even we should not do in our future coming version of Ceph. And but the most important is part of choosing your placement group. So try to choose your placement group I would say early, or assume that because if you are increasing your placement group at a later stage when your cluster is filled up with data, and if you're increasing the placement group, it will trigger too much data replication and recovery if you increase the PG count, and it would be one of the most intensive operation in a cluster. So it's nice to judge your requirements or predefine your requirements and build Ceph pools on in advance. And again, yes, decreasing a placement group is not currently supported, so choosing a placement group is quite important. For version upgrades, yes, they work quite nicely. And if you are running, because this is the problem that we had a few months back, if you are running fat nodes where you have a large number of OSDs, you might require to tune your kernel for PIDMAX and PIDTHREADS. Otherwise, the OSD, someday OSD will complain that I am not able to boot up because I don't have threads. Some more operational experiences is, you might see blocked operations or slow OSDs or slow requests. So this is a bit common. So to diagnose these things, you should have to find out which OSD is causing the problem and which node is causing the problem. If you are successful in doing that, then you just take that OSD out, and even if multiple OSDs are there, you have to take the entire node out. This should rebalance your cluster, and the cluster should run after that quite nicely. But there are chances that, what I have seen is, in a cluster, you will randomly see OSDs which are giving slow request. So it's not like one OSD, it's not like one node, it's like random OSDs across the random nodes giving you this problem. So in this case, you should check the network, because what we have found out recently in our problem analysis is that the Ceph cluster was quite healthy, like if you see this one. So this is a screenshot that we have taken before while I was troubleshooting an issue. So the cluster is completely healthy, it's not completing anything. And while I'm writing anything to the Ceph pool, it's giving, it's simply not writing to the Ceph pool. And when I check the load on all the nodes, the load on the system is quite high. So we tried quite many ways to quite many things to troubleshoot and fix this, but we end up doing this, which is I took help from the community, sub community over the IRC, and I tried doing these changes on the file store max sync interval and increase it quite a bit. So what it helped me is the problem or the system load came down after tuning these values, but even the writing was not up to the mark. Then we troubleshooted more from the network point of view, because the system was not giving us any idea, like, is this really a network problem? So we checked on the switch side, and then we agreed to upgrade the switch firmwares. And after upgrading the switch firmwares, the cables that were connected to from the OSCD node to the switch, they somehow, after upgrading the firmware, was not performing good, or it was throwing errors. So then we replaced the cables between the nodes, and then everything came back to life. So my advice would be to check your network twice in case you have a lot many problems with OSDs, nodes coming up, nodes going down, going out, and you are not getting right performance from your cluster. So so network is something that you should check twice. Okay, coming back to my point that I was discussing. So you'd also like to tune your crush tunables to the latest one. I think that's Straw 2, which is out there. But if you do that, you would trigger a lot of data movement inside your Ceph cluster. So this is something you should plan quite ahead before you have a lot of data on your system. And from Ceph recovery and backfilling so the Ceph default recovery and backfilling is quite intensive. And if your cluster is recovering out of two failure nodes, so your client might stop for IO. So temporarily, you might want to reduce the rate of recovery so that the clients can get performance. So you could use the online, the Ceph tell command, which will trigger changes to your Ceph OSDs in a live environment. So this is something which was quite useful for me. So I hope that will also be helpful for you also. So you can temporarily reduce the recovery rate and the backfilling rate. And once, let's suppose if at night, if nobody is using cluster in night, you can enable the recovery rate to be quite high. Then in the morning, again, you can reduce the recovery rate. So this is something I did.
About these tunables that you use in the last in the example, are you using them in your production cluster?
Yes.
Okay, and
I did, but I changed it back. So my production cluster is still using the default one.
Yes.
In production, I faced problem of OSDs getting out and down, and it was recovering. Then I used this command to just for temporarily reducing the recovery rate, and then I made it back.
What kind of load do you have in your cluster? I mean, how much data that you have in percentage? In percentage?
It's not much currently. So it's 50 terabyte, which is used by customers. So out of around 200 terabyte, so it's not that much. We have not got any kind of complaints from the customer, but to be on the safe side, I just reduced the recovery.
What we have found out, for a 270 terabyte cluster, which is filled up to 65%,
mm-hmm.
is that not with all these tunables, but with some, you know, the backfill and the recovery max active and stuff. Even if you tune them with this kind of load, the backfill operation is still not throttled properly. You still have lots of you are producing lots of load that is apparent to the client. The clients are actually seeing a lot of slow requests. If you have a broken node or a broken OSD, even with some of these tunables, you still get the effect. You see the effect of the problem. I believe it's a matter of the cluster load, having filled up the OSD the OSDs up to 65%.
Mm-hmm.
But I think there should be a lot of work done there in order to properly throttle the recovery operation. And
did you change for all the OSDs in the cluster, or for some specific nodes?
When you have a node going down, all the OSDs are going to participate in the recovery.
No, I mean you changed the tunables, right?
Yes.
So did you change the tunable for a specific OSD or for the entire OSD?
For the entire cluster.
That's then weird. So I've never seen this kind of way. But yes, I usually use this this way of reducing it, the recovery of the cluster.
Just be aware, when you change the tunables to optimal, you may render the cluster unavailable on for all clients. For example, KRBD, if you have old version of KRBD, you will not be able to access the cluster when you are with tunables optimal.
Ah, okay.
You have
to
know that.
That's I saw something in the testing, yes. You're true.
And I also want to say something about a tunable stroke version. This morning, some people said we have uneven data placement on all OSD, and you can mitigate this with a tunable called Strokalk version.
Tunable version 2,
Stro_calc_version, and you said 1. Because there was a bug in Stro calculation in old version of Ceph. Sage changes the algorithm, but you have to trigger it in using this tunable Strokalk version 1, and then data placement is more precise.
More precise. Okay. Yeah. Currently, in the development box that we have, the data placement is not even. I still have OSDs which are 66% full, and some OSDs are like 10% full. So the data placement is not even currently. So I still have to tune it for my cluster. But yeah, that's true.
Okay. I'm sorry. I just recalled something that I think may be of use to other people. You said, and very well, that PG splitting is a really intensive operation. So yeah, you should not split too many PGs at one time, because your cluster may be brought to its knees. I don't recall when we introduced this change, but I think it has been backported as far back as it was reasonable. Nowadays, you cannot increase the number of PGs on a pool for any given number. You will always be bound by default, it's 32 PGs per OSD. So if you have 100 OSDs, you will only be able to increase the number of PGs by 3,200 PGs rounded up to the next power of 2. So this will avoid getting into a state in which it's hard for the cluster to recover all the PGs that you are splitting. You can just set this number below 32 if you want, in order to make sure that you don't get to, well, split a lot of PGs. If you have 1,000 OSDs, that would be 32,000 PGs. So you can just set it below 32, or you can increase it if you so wish.
Yep.
I hope this is useful for somebody else.
It would be quite nice to, as he mentioned, that you should reduce the number of PGs in the Ceph configuration file. So if you are creating any pool, it by default will create with less PGs, and then you can manually increase the PG by any time. So it's good.
Yes, we have discussed about this issue as well. Okay, so that's all I have here.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Any more questions? If not, then let's have a coffee. And we come back to the presentations in half an hour, and we will have a similar presentation on the University of PISA installation. So half an hour, yeah?